Tesla announces the mobility revolution. What really? Yes, indeed, it might be that in just 4 months, Teslas could be driving fully autonomously. So you won't have to steer or do anything. Yeah, right, they always promise a whole lot when the day is really very long. Elon Musk has already made many announcements, but now I'm really going to show you lots of concrete examples, actual practical examples from the cars themselves, and give you plenty of information that demonstrates that this can actually happen. This is precisely where everything initially started. Elon Musk, the visionary head of Tesla, announced on X, his innovative brand new platform that was formerly known as Twitter. The Tesla Robotaxi and Wheel event on the 8th of August 8.8 fundamentally symbolizes the 8th of August. August, and of course, that's undeniably quite a spectacular blockbuster hit. Just a few select words, only two crucial numbers, but in my personal, strongly held opinion, they will indefinitely change the world. Because, so let me translate this for everyone, the Robotaxi will... Introduced on August 8th, what precisely is a robotaxi, you might wonder? And what does it genuinely signify or represent? And why is this now a revolution? So, much more importantly, before we dive into that, we'll also talk about prices. We'll discuss what I think, again, as a conclusion and perhaps concerns about the whole technology. But before we dive into that, because I find it very important, there has been so much talk about the topic of autonomous driving, self-driving cars for years, decades. A frequent dream among many: step into a vehicle, it begins to drive itself, navigates to your intended destination, and you exit completely amazed. It even finds a parking spot by itself and so on. Yes, all beautiful dreams. And that's precisely why, before we venture into exploring other diverse topics, I eagerly want to guide you directly into the heart of our current reality, so to speak, to fully grasp it. Because could it conceivably already be in existence? Today, in this exact moment, as you're watching this video, and I venture so far, and I know my mindset is quite progressive, I am eagerly looking forward to embracing the future. I naturally hope things come early, which is why you can, of course, criticize all of this. But I think when we show concrete examples now and how it works, I've put together an entire video. Also, warm regards to the American YouTube colleague, Faza, whom we'll link again, who has also compiled quite a bit. Allow me to show you a few concrete examples of Tesla's current software capabilities. It's called FSD, Full Self-Driving. It has been in its beta version for many, many years. But the truly brilliant aspect of this technology is, with the very latest version, version 12.3.3, improvements can be clearly seen. This really does sound quite crazy, doesn't it? What exactly is he rambling on about with 12.3.3, 10.4? Yes, that is absolutely correct. Indeed, that is precisely the name. It has now evolved past its beta phase, making it substantially more stable. It's now out of beta, and for people who develop software, who are knowledgeable about software, it's really a big step. So it's essentially a final version now. That doesn't mean that fully autonomous driving is fully functional yet, but Tesla now calls it Full Self-Driving Supervised, which is practically supervised fully autonomous driving. It would essentially be fully automated driving according to level 3, because level 2 is what we all are familiar with. These are the assistance systems in the car. It keeps the lane, maintains the distance. It also makes a lane change once you signal with the turn indicator and so on. But level 3 is really about the car driving and me monitoring it. And that would be, well, not just would be, that is the current state in the USA. And I've already made a detailed video about this particular topic, and since then, quite a lot has happened, just 6 weeks or perhaps even 8 weeks. But so much has happened in development. That's the wild part. The whole system runs on advanced artificial intelligence, which is why we're now seeing unexpected and sudden leaps forward. And you see this in other areas too, if you look at things like ChatGPT and such stories. Watches or attentively follows Sora's journey, knows significant leaps happen within months, within a single year, leaps once thought completely impossible. And that is precisely what's unfolding there. Now, within a mere few weeks and months, we are witnessing developments so incredibly significant, it becomes quite difficult to keep pace with them. That's complete madness. Now many testers are on the scene. That's also perhaps a good critique from my last video. From many might have been, well, okay, but you only showed clips from a single YouTuber who reported on it. They were truly very impressive, yes, but that's just only one part. Now the important thing is Tesla has rolled out this particular version to a whole lot of Teslas. I'd even go as far as to say to all Teslas in North America, that's in the USA and in Canada, because now they've released this version which has moved out of beta for all Tesla drivers as a free trial version for this month of April. So that's when I'm recording this video, is being made available. That means now everyone really can give it a try. And the entirety of YouTube in the US is packed with channels and with clips. And like I said, I'm going to show you a whole bunch, and they're almost all from different drivers. And these aren't just any Tesla fanatics. These are regular Tesla owners trying it out for themselves. Because it's said to be free, it costs, I believe, $12,000 in the USA. And now we are going to take a closer and more detailed look at that together. Let's all head inside and explore it. Here you can see it's quite insane. First off, turn right here, then swiftly onto the next lane left, shift another lane left, and continue moving even further left without stopping. So he is driving somewhat diagonally to end up in the very far left lane so that he can make a wide turn right here. It's also a behavior you don't really associate with, let me call them self-driving cars or robots, that's what I call them. So this is undeniably crazy. There's actually no visible road here anymore. There are absolutely no lines, just these towering pylons. And just, yeah, it's really just layers of dust. Yeah, it's simply just a path of dirt. So, and he drives over it, sticks to the pylons, and drives over this flawlessly. I find that quite impressive too. Here, take a very close look on the right, the woman on the right side. So now we need to, I've slowed it down for you again. On the right, the woman in the car, she thinks the car wants to cross, but she's pointing at her own car and says, no, no, I'm about to get into my car. I don't want to cross the street at all. The system recognizes that and then moves on. That's just totally crazy. Here, there should have been an accident. Bam, they're way too close, just like that. And then the vehicle actually swerves. I've also cut this together back to back, slightly onto the sidewalk on the right. A truck is approaching, showing a need for a stop that wasn't made. Space is too tight, risking a left side collision. What actions will the system take to avoid or lessen the crash? Bam, it just accelerates and drives off the road a bit. Well, right onto the sidewalk and then quickly back down or onto that, don't you think? The elevation we're talking about here, it's really quite unusual too, isn't it? Yeah, and that particular robot, it also makes a complete stop for chickens and even for hens, believe it or not. Thus, they truly are indeed very tiny animals, actively scurrying around, also utterly insane. You can see here on the right there, right in the bush, there's another chicken. Do you see that? I didn't even notice at first. It comes out then because I'm thinking, why is that car there? We have to keep going, but there's actually still waiting for the last chicken. So there are no chicken nuggets available today. So then here also really intense, there the robot drives Indy. Parking garage, I have to get used to, I'm saying robot now. So the robot drives into the parking garage and such garages, parking spaces, parking structures, that's not the easiest either. So now I've abbreviated it because it essentially keeps going straight, rounds the corner, and looks for a parking spot. And this is a new system now, the auto parking system, which essentially displays available parking spots directly. You pick one out for yourself. There are also many other clips on the internet showcasing this new auto park feature, and it's parking now. So there are really many examples. You see huge parking lot situations. The software practically recognizes all the boundaries of the parking spaces. So it identifies where there are parking spots, where vehicles are parked, where the parking spots are free. And then there's this new menu that pops up. I can practically choose from the menu. Tapping, for instance, on the screen, or it even does it via the steering wheel. I haven't seen that before. Can you somehow select this one, or that parking spot? I want that, choose it. And it parks by itself automatically. Well, I mean, cars parking themselves isn't exactly revolutionary, but I think it's quite cool how they've integrated it here. So here too, leaving the roundabout, and right here, there's a man coming. I mean, technically, the car really shouldn't have to come to a stop because he definitely shouldn't be crossing at that point, but it's absolutely crucial that the vehicle comes to a halt here so that the robot makes a decision. Human safety always comes first, then it stops right there, lets him carefully cross, and then it moves on. And that's, for instance, what I call a crossroads from hell right around the corner. These are intersections with constant traffic from the left, right. And you're really wondering, when will I actually manage to pull out here, right? So basically, he needs to cross this road just once so he can then successfully get onto the other lane and continue his journey without further interruptions. And take a look at this. This is really crazy. By the way, you can see another camera in the bottom left, which I find quite fascinating. Now, you can clearly see how the Tesla is essentially standing on this median strip, basically, between the two wide road lanes. It keeps on waiting until the right time eventually comes. And these are, I think, situations that are not even easy for anyone at all, really. You always have to find a gap. I notice it often. Many feel unsure about it, and rightfully so. So here you can see, here the system is very, very polite. It's just waiting now because it sees someone wants to exit. and waits, doesn't move all the way forward, just lets this particular driver, so to speak, here, smoothly merge onto the busy roadway. Then takes a clean right turn here. So, and that's what I can tell you, what many have said, it feels human. So in English, they say it feels human, so it doesn't feel like a robot anymore. Here too, it drives straight into a dead-end street. Now it somehow has to turn around. So the system, of course, indeed, the system has to find the precise right angle to make such a turn. Might he need to reset it once more, or is that enough? Yes, and now the driver, I turned off the sound, was totally disappointed. I thought, ah, darn, that really didn't quite work out as I had expected. Now, surprisingly, the robot actually stops right here. But what the system observed, which we didn't, there are actually two people coming with their dogs. And they were arriving, the system was already waiting, then from the right, another one comes in, just walks right in front of the car, the system waits nicely, so now you see here, he's standing over here on the right again, but he's waiting, it's moving on. So this is also smooth as butter. And here, just a quick U-turn. So U-turns aren't exactly the easiest for such robotic vehicles, robot cars. So here it patiently waits with remarkable precision until the oncoming traffic has passed, then makes, I find, a perfect silky smooth U-turn and then gracefully continues on. That's just the way things are. Now engulfed in darkness. Indeed, those are considered things. Darkness, heavy rain, and so forth. In the dark, another intersection. I've cut quite a bit here because the car has been sitting there for a while. I didn't want to show 2 minutes of a car at the intersection. Really stands there quite a while, waiting, checking if something's coming from the left, something from the right, if anyone's turning. So again, another tricky crossroads, and now in the dark too. It is in fact even more challenging than expected, and then really to just wait it out. The system then gradually pushes forward a bit, but not too far, so the hood doesn't jut out onto the road, just like that, bang, boom. That's everything I'm showing you now. The vehicle, it drives itself, this full self-driving software exactly does. So here we've got some rain already, which is good too. So there haven't been any extreme impactful weather events, but I've observed many instances where there's been quite a lot of regular, consistent rain already. I wanted to see if the auto windshield wipers would work now. I haven't figured that out yet. It's quite a little gag, isn't it? But here too, wait beautifully. So, and now he really needs to move to the far left lane in order to be able to turn left ahead. Now the vehicle really must now go ahead and perform such a lane change. Already a second lane change, smooth as silk unfolds. And then, indeed, the final decisive lane change occurs. So it can, and as you observe, there's not very, very much room. But now let's turn very, very nicely to the left here. And by the way, many of the folks had already tried this with the previous version. So version 12 is practically this revolutionary one with version 11. And these particular examples mostly didn't work out very well. I find that it's a little bit fast forward. Please don't be surprised. I find that really intense too. Lots of traffic, multiple lanes, rain, it's busy. You have to look here. Space is tight here, okay? But the camera goes blurry for a moment. Then he has to veer to the left here once again, then merge in. So once again, in those situations with heavy traffic, when merging, you really have to let other drivers go ahead. And now we are about to witness the most complex and trickiest roundabout that I've ever observed a robocab skillfully navigate through. And here the driver writes that this never would have worked with the previous version. And reflect on yourselves, be truly honest with yourselves. Would you navigate this roundabout with the same calmness? Yes, I know, I am fortunate to have the most fantastic, smartest, and absolutely greatest viewers in the world. Of course, you all will manage it, but now, honestly, take a good look at this. I'm just going to be quiet for a moment. There's really something going on. What do you think will happen next? Well, he needs to go left. And now, quite suddenly, bam. And just take a look over there, someone is actually running around on the street, and they are even pushing a car by themselves. Everything went smoothly. Of course, you can all rewind and watch it again for yourselves. You can also conduct a detailed search on YouTube for FSD 12.3, which is very vital to note because it represents the most recent, up-to-date version available. Maybe if you watch the video, there might already be 12.3 something, 12.4. It's happening at such a pace, it's insane. Those were, as mentioned, just a few examples. I have to admit, I found it quite impressive, actually. Okay, now looking at the current Teslas available in the US, by the way, and also in Canada, where there are some notable examples too, it's clear they can drive quite well on their own if they are adequately monitored and supervised. So there are also full videos, entire routes where someone drives for an hour from point A to point B without intervening at all. So then what does that have to do with a robotaxi exactly? Is this what a robotaxi is, really? No, this is basically the software, which, by the way, is already in all Teslas since 2019. Not the software, but all Teslas from 2019 practically come equipped with Hardware 3, already have the capability to do all of that once the software is installed. So it's not just for cars that might come in the future, nor do you need a robotaxi. Instead, it's like a snap when the software finally does come out. Germany's different in Europe. Now we're in the US. China will most likely, almost certainly, arrive a bit sooner than expected in Europe. But then, snap, the software is loaded, and then, in principle, we're ready to go. But I still have a steering wheel in front of me. I still have pedals, of course. I'm still sitting in the seat, and so on and so forth. And the system does everything on its own. By the way, the issue of safety is very, very important in this context. As I said, I will make more videos. Packing everything into one video just doesn't make sense. But, of course, it revolves around it being safer than any human driver. To move forward, we need undeniable evidence backed by thorough and sound data. From Tesla, it's essential for Tesla to show cooperation and actively work with the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration, NHTSA, within the US's legal framework, this particular traffic safety authority, and must then go on to conclusively prove that every single element works properly before it's really, so to speak, fully and comprehensively approved. And the robotaxi, let's creatively spin some ideas together. I will eagerly share all of my thoughts with you. Of course, this is only speculation, but in my personal opinion, it will surely be a vehicle that has no steering wheel and doesn't have an accelerator or brake pedal anymore either. And then you do start thinking, wow, this is really wild and it just does not feel right. I know it's truly just a small glimpse into what the future might hold for us, but I really believe this is precisely what Elon Musk and Tesla on the 8th have in store. August, this very year, 2024, will indeed showcase. And I think it's going to be a two-seater vehicle. And I think sitting there, it's going to be very cozy, like being in a lounge as a two-seater. Everyone has a monitor in front of them. You can watch movies, ideally connect your computer, work inside, have video conferences. Do everything you might possibly want to do on a train journey today. Just aim to do it all more comfortably and with greater ease. But I have the freedom to choose myself when and exactly where I want to go. And that, I firmly believe, could very well be the highly anticipated robotaxi. Yes, without a doubt, the news was all over the place. Everybody had heard about it. Tesla is now closing down the Model 2, the affordable one. $25,000, likely 25,000 to 30,000 euros car, but it's now, so to speak, discontinued. They're not making it anymore. But that's not correct. Elon Musk has already stated that's false. Based on available information, it's fair to say, without doubt, a new innovative platform will emerge soon. The next generation platform, the next generation vehicle. And on this platform, two vehicles will be designed based on this very platform. Practically the Model 2, which I have already discussed extensively in one of my earlier videos. Certainly, take a look at that. It's going to be the vehicle that still possesses a steering wheel, electric power, and a brake pedal. Why? Because, of course, there still are so many markets out there that haven't approved it as of yet. Some individuals might simply not want it to start at all. There are certainly many among you who feel it's all too creepy and would rather take a closer look first. Meaning, of course, one would still want a vehicle that's affordable, an electric car, but one they can drive themselves. But on this platform, there will also be this robotaxi, practically a second variant on this platform. And Tesla is very flexible, saying, let's make more cars on the platform, more cars. So more cars and robotaxis on the same platform, more Model 2. Depending on, so to speak, how the software evolves, depending on how it's received by people, depending on how the individual markets, countries, accordingly allow it. They can, of course, say quite dynamically, okay, now focus more on robotaxis than Model 2. We'll see all of that. And now let's all together imagine, even though it could be hard for quite a few to envision, I understand that I've been dealing with this situation for an incredibly long time. That would happen just like that. Tesla's managing it now, advancing the software to the point where it drives completely on its own. So then what we have is this innovative robotaxi. What does it actually mean for the future then? You won't need a driver's license anymore. You won't need to have your own car anymore because you can simply call up a robotaxi. You don't even need to own it. Someone else can own it and I'll just call it then. Just like a taxi, that's why it's called a robotaxi. It's extremely affordable because it can be utilized all the time, of course. So you really need to understand a car stays still. I mean, I actually read an interesting statistic. A car's used for just one single hour out of 24 in a day at all. on average by every driver. So it's more of a standing vehicle than a moving vehicle. It just sits there mostly. But a robotaxi can drive around constantly. So even if I personally own it, it can still drive around actively carrying other people from point A to point B. If that's what I want, making money for me, and then it'll get used a lot more. It's practically a vehicle that's not just sitting around and occasionally used, but is used all the time and only occasionally sits idle. And of course, this approach makes the overall cost calculation over the many upcoming years much, much more fascinating and intriguing. It becomes much, much cheaper to travel from point A to point B. And all of the experts in that particular field are quite sure, almost certain, that it'll be significantly cheaper than taking a taxi. Much, much cheaper, and likely even cheaper over several years than even public transport. And it's evidently going to be much safer than a human driver. That means no driver's license, no personal car, extremely affordable. Safer than a person, I learned. Those are quite a few good points. And what's dear to me and many others, of course, is a shift in mobility. The cities are crowded. Actually, if you do the math, we probably only need a fifth or a quarter of the vehicles, because with high utilization, a lot fewer vehicles are necessary to still manage the same trips. This means, in the end, fewer parking spaces, more room in the cities for people, for living, for cyclists, for shops. You can let your imagination run wild with it. And what I personally find to be the ultimate thing about it, well, for me personally, everyone probably has their aspect they find interesting or not so very good. You can, certainly, we can thoroughly discuss it in the comments. I firmly believe it's the ultimate and most perfect synergy between a train and a car. So basically, the unparalleled comfort of a train, but with the complete freedom of a car. I just find that to be absolutely fantastic, really. And that's actually the very vision, and I'm pretty confident about this fact, that Elon Musk and Tesla hold dearly on the 8th August will present. And not such fanciful ideas like it will happen someday in 10 years, but it will come sooner than we all think, obviously making any prediction right now. My very own prediction is extremely clear. It will definitely happen this year, or at the absolute latest by the next year, that in numerous cities and even states across the USA, you know, at least Teslas, not yet the Robotaxi, Teslas with this Robotaxi software will be completely cruising around. Please take a good look at this. I'm really going out on a limb here, but I feel I'm quite comfortable with it. Now, let's talk about the price. What's it going to cost? Yes, so the interesting part is it even being sold, this Robotaxi? Or does Tesla directly operate it as a fleet potentially more lucrative for them? Tesla would indeed like to do that, to run the Robotaxi as a fleet on their own, no longer selling them at all. And Tesla has always made it quite clear we will eventually stop selling the cars. Because of course it results in significantly more profit if they're out driving around earning money constantly. Given its relatively high cost, it is probably wise and advisable to consider purchasing the Robotaxi exclusively for personal instead of shared use to ensure maximum value and utility. And if you do not have any particular desire to use it yourself, you are perfectly free and entirely welcome to release it into the expansive Tesla fleet, also known as the Robotaxi fleet. And then the vehicle earns money while I'm not using it, because then others are driving it around. And there you have it. Such a robo-taxi, maybe even two, and while you're not using them, someone else does. Surely some build up their own large fleets that then roam around. And then we come to discuss the price. I think it will be around 30,000 euros. But 50% of the net profits from the robo-taxi service operations will be allocated to Tesla. So Tesla, I believe, will make pretty good money from this. So yeah, I think it will be either a 70-30 split or 50-50. But Tesla will indeed earn a small, significant chunk of every single ride with the Robotaxi. But you'll certainly make some money as well, I presume. Within a specific period, which we will definitely need to investigate carefully, I will also do the math once it's officially on the market. I think in about 5 years, you'll likely recoup the cost of the entire vehicle, especially if you're living in a big city like here in Berlin, and it's released to us as a Robotaxi. I know, this may all sound quite insane. That's exactly why I selected the video in this manner. I've given this quite a lot of thought. I really think it's truly revolutionary. This is indeed the biggest thing coming in mobility. And I shall say it again, it applies to all of the Teslas once the software is rolled out from Autopilot 3 hardware, that is, since 2019. It will then be wirelessly deployed directly to the vehicles via an extensive over-the-air update. Of course, you'll have to pay for that. In the USA, there's also subscription model. That would be interesting too, to subscribe on a monthly basis. Sometimes you have it, sometimes you don't. You can try it out. And is it only about Tesla? No, it isn't at all, and that's extremely important, for it unveils a vision so incredibly grand and far-reaching. And they should, of course, work not only in Tesla vehicles. Tesla and Elon Musk have consistently made it clear this is supposed to be available as a license for all manufacturers. And I think, and this is also a guess of mine, that we will still, this year, or at the latest next year, hear an announcement that a major car manufacturer licenses this system and the software from Tesla and practically moves away from this leader system. And just like that, maps scanned in very high resolution are driven. It's incredibly complex how the others are attempting it. It's all very complicated in this field. And then to this camera system with the computer set, which is much, much cheaper if it actually works. But I think based on the examples I showed today, it's clear to see that this can't obviously be the completely wrong way to go with the cameras, even in the rain and so on. But perhaps I'm totally blinded by this, and every single one of these individuals who are trying it out are just absolutely, truly, deeply thrilled. They are all on Tesla's payroll. Well, I personally think that nowadays it's truly absurd to even criticize, but I am staying firmly on it. And of course, it's significantly good that we are actively discussing it. And for example, I want to make another video for the channel about what it's actually like in Europe, because obviously we've been talking mainly about the USA and Canada. So what is the current situation in Europe now? What are our rules? Can we really anticipate something of this nature happening in the foreseeable future here, or are certain regulations going to put obstacles in our path? I can't fully answer that for you just yet. All I know so far from bits and pieces of hearsay here and there is that it's probably not that great for us here in Europe. That's why the situation doesn't look so great at the moment. But again, like I mentioned, I don't want to preempt everything by putting it all into one video. I've already talked way too much. Subscribe to the channel, then you won't miss more exciting videos in this series. And could you please take a moment to write below the video, are you genuinely excited and looking forward to this future, just like me? Or, and of course, this is important, are you skeptical? Do you say, I don't know? I might also be a bit afraid of it. Then go ahead and write in the comments what you think about it. I'd be absolutely thrilled. It's a passion project of mine, truly. That's the reason why there will be quite a few additional videos in the near future on our channel. And now, I will leave you alone with these numerous thoughts I've just carefully planted in your heads. But you're not alone. I'm with you. See you soon.